Study now that I think is a very important study. It's found here in Matthew chapter 7, and it is a study that relates to danger, because there is a danger. There is a danger in having what is called said faith. You see, there are those who have said faith. It's also been referred to as head faith, which simply means that they have an ability to communicate or to say certain things that may have certain biblical realities or truthfulness to them. They have a said faith. They're able to answer questions. So if you ask them, for example, do you believe the Bible is the Word of God? They're able to say, well, yes, of course. If you say to them, do you think that God has a son named Jesus Christ? They'll say to you, well, yes, he had a son named Jesus. Do you believe that Jesus Christ died on a cross for the sins of the world? Well, yes, of course he did. Do you believe that he was buried? Yes. Do you believe that he rose from the dead on the third day? Yes, indeed. Do you believe that he ascended into heaven? Yes, I do. Did he send the Holy Spirit to reside within those who by faith confessed and received him as Lord and Savior? They would say, well, yes, I believe all of that. I believe in the Trinity. I believe in heaven. I believe in hell. I believe the Bible is the Word of God. And then if you say to them, do you live for Jesus Christ? Well, that's a different question entirely now, isn't it? Well, no, I believe all these things. Well, if you believe all these things, well, blessed are you if you do them. And that's what the Lord is speaking about here. You see, he's been giving to us what is called the Sermon on the Mount. And as we've been going through the Sermon on the Mount, starting in chapter 5, now into chapter 7, we've been seeing how the Lord has come to a point where he has given an invitation. He's been speaking to the people concerning the things that relate to faith in him, and he has said, you need to realize that no man can serve two masters. And so he gave the invitation, and I'm kind of like just going over reviewing this with you, how he had said that these are the things that you need to do. And so he had given an invitation. We saw it in verses 13 and 14, where Jesus had said, enter into the straight or the narrow gate. And so he was beginning at that point to share concerning the cost of discipleship and giving an invitation for people to enter into this narrow gate. So he had actually contrasted what is called the narrow gate with a broad way. The narrow gate is difficult. It's tortuous. It's hard to get into. But the broad way, anybody can go through. And so he's talking concerning a decision that needs to be made related to our life's decisions. There are two paths that have been set before us. You need to choose the spiritual path that you're going to travel. Again, one path is narrow. That means demanding. It speaks of torturous or strenuous. And that's the path of salvation. So Jesus was saying, listen, the way of the cross is difficult. The way of the cross is afflicted or cramped. It's demanding. It's costly. Sacrifice is necessary if you're going to enter in. The Christian life is not an easy life. It is a demanding way of life. He says that in Mark 8, 35 through 37, when he says, whoever wants to save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world yet forfeit his soul? What can a man give in exchange for his soul? So you may watch the news, or you might be reading the newspaper, or you might be on your on the internet and you're reading the news in that way. Whatever fashion you receive your news and all, and you read about a well-known Hollywood personality, whether it's a young lady or a man. They have everything going for them, it appears. And yet they're getting divorces. They have multiple relationships. They're unhappy people, but they have everything. I mean, in the back of your mind, if you grew up like most Americans, you're thinking, if I have health and I have some finances, I'll be fine. I'll do okay in life. If I have strong health and if I have some money in my hand, I'll be okay. Because that's basically what every American is raised to believe. Health and wealth. If I have my health, I can have wealth. But if I don't have my health, it doesn't matter if I have any wealth. But then again, if I have wealth and I have poor health, at least I can go get some hospital care. So we think that way. That's how we think. Jesus says, what good does it do to a man? What does it profit a man if he gained the whole world? And yet he loses his soul. What will a man give, he said, in exchange for his soul? You see, the Lord Jesus Christ says that a soul is costly. And there's nothing you can do to redeem yourself. Nothing. And You can have tremendous experiences, and I'm not knocking tremendous experiences. There are certain joys that we have just by being alive. It's great sometimes to be able to sit down in your own backyard, say you have a backyard, and to have a cup of coffee and to hear the birds and, you know, and hear the children play. Yeah, that's great. I love it. I am so blessed and happy that that's part of my life. But is it my whole life? You know, and do I thank the one who made that all possible? And what if I gained everything? What if I had whatever car it may be that I'd like to have? And there are cars out there, by the way. I like to look at cars like I like to look at art. You know, I'll look at cars and say, well, that's a nice car. But what if I had the ability? What if I was like a Bill Gates or somebody like that where I could walk in and say, oh, this car, you know, okay, say I do. Say I can buy that. Say I can drive that. Does that really, is that going to be everything? Is that, no, of course not. Because the moment there's a chip on the paint, I've lost my joy. I don't care. I'll be sitting in the car and somebody will let go of their shopping cart. And it seems to weave its way through all cars until it gets to mine, hits the door, and then bang, it's all over, you know? So I've learned that. You've learned that. If you haven't learned it, you will. It's just part of life. You discover those things. But what does it profit a man if that man is a very handsome man? What does it profit a woman if that woman is so very beautiful that all women, she walks in the room and the women will look at her and say, oh, she looks so nice. It's kind of like that. That commercial, you know, where that woman's walking on the beach and this guy's got this woman has a hearing aid on that she can hear all the talk that's going on around her, and then she walks by these two women on the beach. Maybe you've seen it. I laugh every time I've seen it. And she goes, oh, doesn't, this one girl turns to the other one and says, oh, doesn't she look so wonderful? I wish I had a shape like that. And she's got this sonic ear or whatever, and she can hear them. That's exactly what those women are saying, I'm sure. They're just saying, I wish I had a body like that. She looks wonderful. No, I don't think I'd want to hear the things people whisper around me. But is that what it's all about? I mean, is that what we want? Well, obviously not. So Jesus is making it very clear to us. He's saying to us, we need to know what matters and what doesn't. And walking with the Lord is costly, and walking with the Lord can be very difficult. But he never taught us that being a follower was an easy life. It is a life that can be difficult, and it can end in a difficult way. When we were in Mexico recently, I didn't know that where we were going was well known for kidnapping. I didn't know that. Not that I wouldn't have gone. I just made sure that I put Marie next to the door. No, I didn't know that. And so they sent me, the people who were hosting us sent me a picture on my phone of two guys and said, these are the ones who are going to pick you up. I didn't put two and two together until later. And I turned to Maria and I said, I think they're protecting us from being kidnapped at the airport. So these two guys come, they put us in the car, they're driving, and now they're talking to us, and they say, well, we're going to a place where it's run by cartels. But the cartel here is into kidnapping. So that made some sense. Oh, okay, kidnapping. He said, yeah. And I said, oh, great. He said, well, that's how they make their money. And now they're beginning to speak to us and tell us of what has happened in the church. And then we hear this. We hear that one of the members of the church, a businessman who had some money, was kidnapped. A member of the church was kidnapped and held for ransom. And what happened is the ransom was paid, but they killed him anyway. And they never recovered his body, only his head. And I said, can you take us back to the airport? No, but he goes, They only recovered his head after the ransom was paid. But you know what happened? They're telling us. We had an outreach. There was an outreach that was put on by the church. And a young man, 20 years of age, came to that outreach. And that young man answered the invitation and gave his heart to the Lord, 20 years old. At the end, when they were interviewing and speaking to him to follow up with him, he said the reason he came to that outreach is he was the one who was part of the kidnapping of the man who had been abducted from that church. And he was the one who killed the man. And he said, you know what has driven me to have come here? And they said, what? He said, when I was threatening him, about to kill him, he said, the man looked at me and said to me, I said to him, you're not afraid. Why aren't you afraid? And the man said, I am not afraid because I have peace with God through Jesus Christ. I have peace. But son, you don't. And he said, and I shot him and I killed him. I killed the man, but it's haunted me because he was right. I have no peace. And he did, and I saw him to the end when he died, and when I killed him, that he died with a peace that I didn't possess. And that is what drove me to come to this church, because I knew that he goes to this church, or went to this church, and I needed to have what he had. Now, that story continues, because they said, you need to turn yourself in for what you've done. And he did. And this young man who gave his heart to Christ as a result of killing another man, he himself was killed by the cartel in prison. He gave his heart to Christ, and he died, and he wanted to die in peace, the way the other one died in peace. Listen, Christianity is not something that's lightweight. It's not lightweight. And Jesus is making it very clear, and I'm sad to say that here in the United States, sometimes we just don't count the cost. We don't understand that Jesus wasn't saying to us, listen, enter in and you'll have a great life always. He said, it is a difficult path. It is a strenuous one. It is very narrow and cramped, and few there be that find it. Whereas on the other hand, the other one is a broad way, and there be many who go therein. And that's because they're not willing to do what you're called to do in order to enter into the kingdom of God. The narrow gate is entered in through a conscious and considered decision. And it's a decision of the will, because you don't simply stumble into the kingdom of God. You are not automatically, you are not accidentally, you are not ritually, and you are not simply born a Christian. I'm an American, I must be a Christian. I've been raised religious, I must be a Christian. I was teaching a Bible study. A young woman comes to the Bible study, we're talking after the study and all, and as I'm speaking to her, I say to her, when did you become a Christian? When were you born again? She says, I've always been a Christian. And I smile at her, and the Spirit of the Lord speaks to my heart. I still remember hearing the voices. He said, she's lying. And I remember looking at, and I actually said this. This is a true story. I'm not making this up for effect. It's true. I remember hearing this. She's lying. And I remember saying, yes, I know. It was like a conversation. So I said, are you telling me you were born again? You can't be born again. You're born of water or you're born of spirit. And I spoke to this young woman and explained to her how you're born again. But this young woman believed, oh no, I was raised a Christian. I've always been a Christian. I was born a Christian. And I'll give you her name. Her name was Marie, my wife. When I met her, that was our first conversation. We sat down after the Bible study, and I asked her, Marie, when were you born again? When did you become a Christian? Her first response was, I've always been a Christian. Her second question was, what's your sign? Because she was going to college at that time, and she wanted to know my sign. So I said, the fish. Oh, you're a Pisces. I said, ichthus. I don't believe in that garbage. And that was our first conversation. And so you're not born again. You enter in by faith. It's not automatic. It's not ritual. Listen, when I was 4 months old, my mama took me to a small church, the Plaza Church, right out there by Alvera Street. All of you know it. Some of you went there too. I was baptized there in December of 1950. My mama took me there, 4 months old, and I received water baptism. 7 or 8 years of age, I received First Communion. 12 or 13, I received confirmation. If you would have asked me, are you a Christian? I would have said, absolutely. Well, how do you know you're a Christian? Do you believe in the Bible? Yes, I do. Do you believe that God has a son named Jesus? Yes, I do. Do you believe in heaven? Yes, I do. I would have answered, is there a Trinity? Yes, there is. I would have answered because in catechism class, I was taught all the answers for that. But if they said, do you live for God? Are you born again? I would have answered what I was taught. When I was an infant, I received water baptism. The Spirit came upon me at confirmation. I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Yes, I'm a Christian. That's what I was taught. But what you're talking to me, I might have been loaded or drunk. That was my life. I mean, my cousin Carly and I had arguments. I still remember arguing. He was Jehovah's Witness. I was Roman Catholic. And we argued while smoking pot as to which faith was true. So some of you understand exactly what I'm saying. Some of you have done exactly what I've done. This isn't unusual. This is typical of many people, not all people, but many people, where you know what Christmas is supposed to celebrate. You know what Easter is supposed to celebrate. If you get married, you get married in the church. Then you raise your kids to make sure the wife, if you're a man, the wife takes the kids to church, because every family ought to go to church once in a while. You go for weddings, you go for funerals. You go for baptisms, you go for the whole thing. And yet you say that he is Lord, but you don't do what he says. And that's the difference, and that's what Jesus is speaking about here concerning Christianity. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. You see, the narrow gate is the opposite of the broad way because it is demanding and costly. In Matthew 16, 24 and 25, Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. A man by the name of Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote a book called The Cost of Discipleship. And Dietrich Bonhoeffer said, when Christ calls a man, he bids him come and die. Because that is the cost. You see, the narrow gate isn't crowded because there are few, Jesus said, who find it. Now, you'd think that the road would be crowded for entrance into heaven. Instead, there's a disinterest to entering in, even a resistance. In John 5, 39 and 40, he said this. He said, you search the scripture, for in them you think that you have eternal life. And these are they which testify of me. But you're not willing to come to me that you may have life. You're not willing to come to me. You search the scriptures, you can get into Bible study, you can understand it. The word search, every police officer in this room understands the word search. The real word is ransack. Somebody comes in just recently in our neighborhood, one of the homes in our neighborhood was ransacked. They turned everything over. They go into the bookshelves and pull things out. They find everything. They go underneath the sofas. They take the sofa cushions out. They open up the bed, take the mattress off of it. They looked everywhere. They ransacked. That's what the word ransack means. So you're reading the news and they says this house was ransacked. It means everything was turned over. When Jesus is speaking here, he says, you search the scriptures. The word search is you ransack the scriptures. You're looking from A to Z. You're ransacking it. And these are they which speak concerning me. But you won't come to me. You may know the Bible. You may be able to quote the Bible. You may be in Bible study from the time you were small to this point now. But you haven't committed yourself to me. In a world so populated, the amount of people entering into the kingdom is very small. That's why Jesus in Luke 12, 32 speaks of it as being a little flock. The obvious question is for us as we go through this, is because this Jesus is an intent. The obvious question is, am I part of that little flock, or am I one of those who says to him, Lord, Lord? The other path, as mentioned a moment ago, is the broad way. It leads, he said, to destruction. This path is one that is more readily traveled because the narrow gate isn't that attractive. Dying to self, picking up a cross, loving your enemies, serving God, that's not desired by most people. Instead, when possible, they will try to choose their own path. And their own path normally conforms to their own personal philosophy. Yet we're told in Proverbs 16, 25, there's a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death. In John 8, 24, Jesus said it like this. He said, if you don't believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. So Jesus was speaking concerning the way into heaven. When we got to verses 15 through 20, he then began to issue a warning concerning false prophets and false teachers. And as mentioned earlier, as you walk this narrow way, some will attempt to mislead you and draw you off the path. He had said they will come to you in sheep's clothing. When he says they come to you, they're on the prowl. They prowl the road. They deceive those who would enter into the narrow gate. And some of you know this very well through experience. Very often, false teachers are more evangelistic than the genuine believer. They train their disciples. They pour millions into literature. They purchase buildings. They have door-to-door evangelism. The disciples are very often totally devoted and extremely sacrificial. And the minute God begins to move, the enemy does what he can to undermine the move of God. As I mentioned to you recently, you get saved, and within a week or two, 3 weeks, there's someone knocking on your door. There's someone inviting you someplace else. They want to take you down a path that actually takes you away from the Lord, not towards him. When God began to move in the United States in a modern revival in 1970 and all of that, when it began to be called the Jesus Movement, not only was God moving in a refreshing way amongst many people my age and all, 18, 19, 20 years of age and all at that time, but not only was the Holy Spirit moving, but the enemy did everything he could to upset it. There was a group at that time called the Children of God. Some of you have heard of the Children of God. I know somebody who was part of that. It was a mind-controlling cult. And it was led by a guy named Moses. He called himself Moses David. And one of my friends who liked to play rock and roll guitar and all was at Griffith Park. And this was before I got saved. He was at Griffith Park, and the Children of God swarmed the park, and he was spoken to by some of these members of we call them COG, the Children of God, the Family of God later on. They called themselves by various names, but Children of God is what I knew them by. And what happened is they took him, and he began to live on a commune. He sold all his possessions. He didn't really have much, but he got rid of his guitar, donated it to that organization, and they did everything they could to control this young man. That was very typical, and that happened then, and it happens to this day. Jesus is leaving it up to his listeners to exercise discernment by saying to them, beware of false prophets. You see, we're responsible to know God's word, and God's word needs to be known well enough for us to be able to discern or to spot error. You know, in these last days, and indeed we're in these last days prior to Christ's return, and it's soon. When Jesus was spoken of, and we'll see this when we get to Matthew 24, that's only 16 chapters or so from now, that's only 2 years. When we get there to Matthew 24, Jesus's attention is drawn to the temple. His disciples say, isn't this beautiful? Look at these marvelous stones and this and that. And Jesus begins to speak to them in return and says, listen, not one of these stones are going to be left in place. They're all going to be uprooted. And it causes the disciples great concern because Herod had been working on that temple for over 40 years. It had been beautified to such an extreme degree that the idea that this beautiful temple would be destroyed was much beyond them. And so they began to speak to Jesus, and they said, tell us, when will these things be? What are the signs of your coming? We all know that. When you read Matthew 24, we all know about the plagues, the wars, the rumors of war, and a variety of things that are listed there. But it's interesting because when the disciples are speaking to Jesus, they did not say, and you'll see this clearly, just read it yourself, you'll see it, but when we get to it, I'll try and develop this for you. But they did not say, what are the signs of your coming? It's not plural, it's singular. They said, what is the sign of your coming? And what was it that Jesus said? Three times, at least three, some say four, at least three times he says, take heed that ye are not deceived. The sign of the return of Christ isn't simply the plagues, the wars, the international wars. Those are all part of, they're like birth pangs. But the real sign is deception. And that's why Jesus said, take heed, be careful that you are not deceived. And that's why Jesus is speaking about beware false prophets. Listen, as a pastor teacher, I can do the best that I can to try and equip you. I can do the best, and that's my responsibility, and I do the best I can to do that. But the way you're equipped is by reading the Word yourself, studying the Word yourself, having your own personal time with God yourself in your prayer, having fellowship with those who love Jesus Christ and live for Him, learning to share your faith with other people. Those are all things that you do that helps you, but it's especially through the reading and the practicing of the Word of God that you're safeguarded. God's Word needs to be read. It needs to be properly divided. It needs to be understood spiritually. And that's the foundation of all true ministry in Christ. The learning of and practicing the Word of God is a foundation of a blessed life as well as a productive life. You might find this interesting. When we built this building out and began to occupy it 12 or 13 years ago now, we told the church, some of you were with us then, we said on Saturday, this upcoming Saturday, before we lay the carpet, we're going to write our favorite scriptures on this platform. If we were to uproot this carpeting here, all the way to the back doors on both sides, all the way to the back here, everywhere, if you uproot this carpet, you will find hundreds and hundreds of verses. Hundreds, and all the way up the steps, every one of these steps is covered with scripture. Every one. Every step that you take to get up here, there are Bible verses on every that. People with the magic markers, you know, anyway, I was going to... Little savage. No, but there are sad girls right there. No, when you, I'm sorry, but when you look at the concrete, every inch of this has Bible verses. Every inch. Every time I teach, right here, I have the scripture that I wrote. No other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Right here, 1 Corinthians 3:11. I stand on that every time I teach to remind myself it's Jesus. It's the foundation of Christ. It's the Word of God. My mom and my dad's scriptures right here. Right next to me. I wrote their scripture. Both of them are in heaven. But it reminds me this church is built on the foundation of the Word of God. That's what it's supposed to be built on. It reminds me every time I teach. You see, our responsibility is to know God's Word. False teaching ultimately produces multitudes of lost people who mistakenly believe they're going to heaven. And that's your introduction to our study, verse 21. I give long introductions. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. I underscored says, and I underscored does. Says versus does. Someone says, well, wait a minute. I know I've been reading the Bible, and I know that the Bible says that we confess Jesus Christ as Lord in order to be saved. So isn't this a contradiction? Because it seems to be different than what Jesus taught. Because in Matthew 10:32, Jesus says, whoever confesses me before men, him I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. So isn't this a contradiction? On the one hand, he says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven. And yet later on he says you have to confess him before men to be part of the kingdom. How does that work? Well, there are those who would say that all you need to do is say Jesus is Lord. And if you do, then you are going to be recognized as a believer in him. Not that long ago, there was a bus that was going around in our area here where it said on the bus, I'll never forget, it had an advertisement. You know how you can buy space on buses and it drives through the city. And it said, say Jesus is Lord and you will be saved. And I'll never forget seeing that bus. It was driving through. Say Jesus is Lord and you shall be saved. There are whole denominations that say that if you're saved, you're going to stand up, and they'll do this. They'll stand up in the platform just like this on a Sunday morning, and the young people will walk up and they'll say, Jesus Christ is Lord. Because they believe that no one can call Jesus Lord if they're not saved. They take that out of 1 Corinthians 12:3, where Paul says, I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus accursed, and no one can say that Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. So, over the years, many have been confused over this one issue of confessing Christ. And they wonder about that. I've talked to, as so have you, who will speak to you and say, they've spoken to me and they say, well, I have a friend or I have a relative, and this person is opposed to God. And I'm concerned for them, but the thing that is confusing me is they went forward at an altar call, or they were at a crusade, or they prayed a sinner's prayer, but now they have no interest in God. They're living sinfully, and sometimes they even mock the faith of Christ. And so they'll ask me, I've had this many times, this is one of the questions I've been asked a lot of times, aren't they saved? Because they went forward, they prayed, aren't they saved? Now again, remember, earlier Jesus warned them concerning false prophets who would come and deceive them. He issues a warning concerning deception, a deception that is worse than a deception of a false prophet. And what is it that is worse than the deception of a false prophet? The thing that is worse than the deception of a false prophet is self-deception. You're deceiving yourself. You see, churches this morning, and this is not something I rejoice in saying. It is a true statement. It is a fact. But churches this morning are filled with self-deceived people. There are many cultural Christians. They fill pews, but they're completely unsaved. They attend church. They live unrepentant lives. There's no spiritual hunger. They have no spiritual discipline. And then they get confused when things aren't going well for them. They're surprised. I'm a Christian. Why is God not blessing my life? Some think they are Christian, but they've never really thought deeply about what that means. They haven't done any soul searching, because in reality, it's not that important to them. That will result in them falling short of knowing the Lord. We need to soberly consider if we truly have a genuine relationship with Jesus Christ. In Psalm 119, verse 59, the psalmist said, I thought about my ways and turned my feet to your testimonies. I thought about my ways. It's something I considered, and I turned my feet to your testimonies. In the Old Testament book of Lamentations, chapter 3, verse 40, let us search out and examine our ways and turn back to the Lord. So Jesus is warning against the danger of said faith, the danger of casual faith. And he's challenging them to consider themselves. Make sure where you stand with the Lord. 2 Corinthians 13:5, examine yourselves as to whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Do you not know yourselves that Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you are disqualified? Examine, test, see whether you're in the faith. Look at your own heart. Does Jesus Christ really reside there? Like the psalmist said in Psalm 139, 23 and 24, search me, O God, know my heart. Try me, know my anxieties. See if there's any wicked way in me. Lead me in the way everlasting. Am I walking with the Lord, or am I self-deceived? Self-deception is demonstrated by saying, but not doing. Saying that we're Christians. Saying that he's the Lord. Well, that's not the same as living as if he really is. Jesus asked a question. It's one of the more powerful questions. You find it in Luke 6:46. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Why do you speak me in that way? Why do you say to me what you're saying when in reality that's not true at all? In Romans 6:17, thanks be to God that you who were once slaves of sin have become obedient from the heart to the standard of teaching to which you were committed. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Americans have basically taken a model of education that is like this. It's like if I am able to take a test and repeat the things that the professor has given to me, answer enough questions right, then I can get a diploma and that will prove that I'm educated. That's the American system, basically, isn't it? As long as I pass enough of the tests, as long as I repeat the things the professor thought was important for me to know, and I can answer those questions, I get a diploma, and ultimately I have my bachelor's or master's or whatever, and I'm an educated person. I have knowledge. The Jews didn't think like that. That's why Jesus would say it's more than saying, it's the doing. That's what he's saying here. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father. Because in the way of thinking of the time of Christ, and even to this day, true knowledge is the accumulation of information and then the assimilation of that information so that it produces a transformation of behavior. I've heard it, I've taken it in, and it's changed the way I live. So somebody can run around saying, oh, I know, and they can quote, and I've had conversations, so have you, over the years with people who will quote a scripture to you, and they know what the scripture says, but Jesus said it like this. He said, blessed are you if you not only know this, blessed are you if you do these things. It's not that you're able to answer. It's not an exam. We're not going to stand before God. He's not going to hand us a multiple choice kind of quiz to enter into the kingdom of heaven. It's not going to be that way at all. It's going to be, is he really my Lord? And Jesus said there are multitudes of people who say he is, when in reality, he's not. You see, today what happens is we've encouraged people to what we would call a show of faith, but sometimes we have encouraged them to a false show. So we say raise your hand at an invitation. We say pray, walk an aisle. And people do, but they don't truly repent. There may be something motivating them. They may be regretting something they've done. A lot of people come to church on a Sunday because they did some bad things on Saturday. And they feel terrible. You know what I'm talking about. They did some bad things. They regret it. They were caught. Or they're going to deal with something. I have been in the ministry a long time, and I've been there myself. So, yeah, you go to church because, man, I feel terrible about what I've been and what I've done. And I regret it, but I'm not repentant. It's not like I turned from it. It's that I feel bad. I hurt somebody's feelings, or I stole something, or I was so drunk, or I got arrested, or whatever. I got to get some God. I need help. And so, please, I have prayed for people, and the thing they were concerned about is lifted. And then I never see them again. Off they go. Back to what they were doing, because they really didn't repent. They simply felt bad. I remember giving an invitation in this church many years ago, not in this building, in another one that we occupied. And three people came forward. It was an older woman, a younger woman, and a younger man. And as I was looking at them, the younger man had his hands in his pocket, and he was obviously angry. And the younger woman was kind of like, what am I doing here? And the older woman was standing a little bit behind him, just staring at both of them, really angry. Well, I thought, this is interesting, you know, what's going on here? Well, I found out afterwards, it was the mother. She was mad at her son. She said, you need God. Get yourself up there right now. And she marched him up the aisle. I don't think he got saved. But sometimes that happens. You need God. You need to get up there. You go up there. You give him a try. No, you don't give God a try. You surrender to God. You surrender to him. You're not giving him a shot. I'll let you prove yourself to me. Show me you're God. Make my life better. That's not how it works. Sometimes people understand grace in a wrong way. They look at God's grace as being more freedom to continue in unrepentant sin. Grace is understood in contrast to God's justice. It isn't permission to sin. It's the strength to resist being in bondage to it. It's not permission to continue. Paul said in Romans chapter 6, 1 and 2, what shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? You see, true conversion produces true Christianity. The evidence that you actually have been converted, the evidence that you know the Lord, it's love. It's love for Jesus, love for God's word, love for other people. Jesus in John 14, 15 said it like this. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. In Jeremiah 15, 16, it says, your words were found. I ate them. Your word was to me the joy and rejoicing of my heart. I am called by your name, O Lord God of hosts. John 15, 12, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. So when you get saved, your life changes. Okay, is it one day you're just a rowdy monster type? The next day you're Billy Graham? No. You go to bed after going forward or praying or whatever it is. You wake up the next morning and God begins that process of cleaning your life as you yield to him daily, every day. Once again, Lord, I'm just asking you to work in my life today. You know, sometimes we want people's lives to be cleaned up before they're even saved. And for me, something I was taught a long time ago was this: you never clean a fish until you catch it. And God has a way of catching us and then cleaning us. And he cleanses us by the word of God. He cleanses us through prayer. He cleanses us by his spirit. He cleanses us through the blood of Jesus Christ. He cleanses us through godly fellowship. He cleanses our lives in that fashion. And so when you're saved, you begin to love Christ. You love his commandments. You love his word. And you love one another. And here's something for you. A true Christian cannot practice sin with satisfaction or joy. Can a true Christian backslide? Yes. Can a true Christian do some of the things they used to do in the past as a non-Christian? Yes. Now then what are you saying? I'm saying that you can't do that and enjoy it anymore. You just can't. Why? Well, because you're a Christian. Because God's Spirit resides within you. Because you sense a conviction, a grief, a sorrow. Because you say, this is wrong. I can't do this. I was a young man, just got out of the service. I went to, I was 22 years old. I went to Ensenada on Cinco de Mayo, 1972. For 3 days, I was so drunk I didn't even know where I was. We drank 2 cases of beer before we got to the border. There were 3 of us. So we killed 2 cases of beer before we got to the border. And then for the next 2 days, it was a lost weekend. I don't even remember what we did. I was that bad. I decided I'm just going to, you know, I'm bored, I'm tired. And I got home. My sister Madeline's at my parents' house when I arrived. I walked in and I was still a little drunk. We'd been drinking for 3 solid days. She says, how did you enjoy yourself in Mexico? I had a great time. And I started telling her the crazy things we did. And then at the kitchen table, I looked her in the eye, and she's just kind of looking at me because I had led her to faith in Christ. And I started to weep. I just broke down. Right there, I still remember just crying at the table and putting my hands on my head. And I am the most miserable man. I am so lost. I can't do this anymore. I've got to get right with God. I can't take this anymore. I've walked away from the Lord. I went to church that night. The evangelist gave a message, gave an invitation. I stood up and I said, I'm going to follow Christ. I don't want to go back to that way of life. Can a believer go back to the slop that you used to live in, the vomit, the dog returned to the vomit? Can you? Yes, you can. But will you stay there? No. Why? Well, because pigs will go back to the mire and a dog will go back to the vomit, because the dog is a dog and the pig is a pig. But you're not a pig and you're not a dog. You're a son or a daughter of God Himself. And the conviction of the Spirit is so huge until you come back to faith in Him. How do I know that? Well, it's not just my experience. It's the Word of God makes it very clear. In 1 John 3:9, no one who is born of God will continue in sin because God's seed remains in him. He cannot go on sinning because he's been born of God. This is the Holy Spirit that convicts you. And some of you perhaps, I don't know, I don't want to point a finger at anybody here, but perhaps there are some here today that this is resonating with, that you've been trying to live on both sides at the same time, and God is saying, choose this day who you're going to serve. You cannot do both, and you're miserable. You need to get right with the Lord. In 1 John 2:3-4, we know that we have come to know him if we obey his commandments. The man who says, I know him, and doesn't do what he commands is a liar. The truth's not in him. And that's why Jesus said, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom. See, these people confessed Jesus with their mouths. They did not honor him with their lives. Now, in verse 22, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. See, the fact is that just because someone says something doesn't mean it's true. The word Lord was a common word during the time of Jesus. It was used as a title of respect. But to address Jesus as Lord is different. You are professing faith in Christ. In John 20:28, Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord and my God. In Romans 10:9-10, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified. It is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. You see, there are religious people, and that's who he's referring to. They will say on that day, we prophesied in your name. These are people that might even have what is called a spirit-filled or a charismatic appearance of ministry. How is it possible that they will say to him, we prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, we did many wonders in your name? The question has to be asked, did these things actually happen? How is it that they will say that to him? They'll say, we did these things in your name. We prophesied, cast out demons, did miracles. These are religious people. They're claiming to be spirit-filled. Well, there's a couple answers. One, if genuine works actually happened, if genuine works actually were performed, it may be that these were just counterfeits empowered by Satan himself. Can Satan counterfeit? Well, according to 2 Thessalonians 2:9-10, the coming of the lawless one will be in accordance to the work of Satan, displayed in all kinds of counterfeit miracles, signs, and wonders. Every sort of evil that deceives those who are perishing, they perish because they refuse the love of the truth and so be saved. And so, yes, is it possible that the enemy could counterfeit? Indeed. And the second thing is more obvious. They're just claims, false claims. They thought these things were actually taking place when in fact they really weren't. They thought they were doing good works for Christ. In reality, they weren't doing any at all. But they're using them as a way to say, but we did this in your name. And then what does he say in verse 23 as we conclude? Then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me. You who practice lawlessness, depart from me. Listen carefully, and we'll close with this. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand. Of course, I wouldn't do that. There's no need to. We all would raise our hand if I asked this question. If I said, how many of you have been rejected in any time of your life? All of us would raise our hand. All of us have. Every one of us, in one form or another, has been rejected from relationship, by a mom, by a dad, by a brother, a sister, an aunt, an uncle, a grandmother, a grandfather, a neighbor, friend, girlfriend, boyfriend, husband, wife, child. All of us have, right? I mean, not a single one of us has gone through life. If you have gone through life without rejection, I want to be your friend so I can reject you. I mean, every one of us, every one of us has been rejected. We weren't chosen for the team. We didn't make it in the office we were running for. I mean, you can name it. All of us has. All of us. Not a single person in this room has ever gone through life without being rejected. That's just the way it is. You applied for a college, they didn't take you. You applied for a job, they didn't take you. You were rejected, some more severely than others. Some were abandoned, some were hurt, some have gone through emotional pain that nobody can understand other than God himself. That's a fact, we know that. Emotional pain that nobody can understand except God himself. Jesus himself does understand, by the way, he was rejected by men. He was rejected. He understands. That's one of the reasons why you can love him so much, because he didn't reject you. He loves you. Never forget that. Please never forget that. He didn't reject you. I will never, never, never leave you nor forsake you. That's a promise from God. He loves you. Never forget that. That's what keeps you going in the dark hour. That's what keeps you going in the pain moment. It's knowing, though my father and my mother reject me, you will lift me up. You never reject me. And that has kept me going for years and years and years. Let me tell you about rejection. Real rejection isn't when someone didn't want you on the team, somebody didn't hire you for the job, you didn't make it into the college, or husband and wife didn't want you anymore. Real rejection is when you hear the Lord Jesus Christ say, "Depart from me." You don't want to hear that. That's rejection. That's rejection. That is the most serious form of rejection. "I never knew you." Wait a minute. I prophesied in your name. I cast out demons in your name. I did wonders in your name. No, I never, never, never knew you. You and I had no relationship. You only said that you knew me, but you didn't do what I commanded. That's rejection. You don't want to go through that. You don't want to go through that. Here's something for all of us. Do you really know the Lord, really? Do you hunger for him? Do you pray? Do you read his word? Do you really love him? I'm not trying to condemn you. Please forgive me. It sounds that way even as I say it. It's a soul searching. Examine your heart. Search your soul. Is he really that important? If not, then right now we can say, "Oh, Lord, forgive me. I've gotten confused in life, and I've walked away from what I know is true. Forgive me." And you know what? Forgiveness is an instant away. It's a confession away. But I wonder how many in this room think that you're Christian because you're like me, because you went through religious upbringing like I did. You don't have to have been raised Catholic. That's just my testimony. You could have been raised in a Baptist church, a Methodist church, Presbyterian church, Pentecostal church. It doesn't matter. Do you have a relationship with Christ? Because I'm telling you, as I read this book here, Jesus said one of these days, he's going to say, "Depart from me. I never knew you." There was never even a time when you claimed to, you really had a relationship with me, and then you walked away from. No, we never knew one another. You never confessed to me. You never received me. You never were born again. And now you are forever lost. The Bible tells us in Revelation 20, verse 5, anyone not found written in the book of life is cast into the lake of fire. That is gospel. That's a fact. You don't have a chance at that point to excuse yourself. You don't have a chance at that point to give the reasons why you had such a bad time. No, it's just you and God. See, so for me, I take this very seriously. And I want to close on a serious note with that. You need to know whether or not you're right with God. That's my prayer for all of us, beginning with me, to walk with God. To walk with God until God takes us and we see him face to face and we hear him say, "Oh, well done, my good, my faithful servant." Till we hear him say, "Enter into the joy of your Lord." It's been prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Enter in. You don't know what I went through, Jesus. Oh, yes, I do, because I walked with you every step, and I kept you every step, because I loved you every step. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Or you can say, I went to church. I was in Calvary Chapel. You'll say, that's why you're going to hell. I went to church, but you weren't the church. You just went, and there's a difference. We need to know if we are the church, not just that we go to a church. Are you the church?